depressing.
Even the happy songs are sad. We need to write some of the old stuff again, fellas. That's all I'm saying.
Old stuff is old.
So we'll make it new again.
I can't go back in time. We're not surfers. We never have been. And real surfers don't dig our music anyway.
They don't.
Okay, I can't write about the summer and fun and summer and summer and fun and cars. I got different stuff inside me. I gotta get it out.
Welcome to Musicians Movie Club. I am Dan.
My name's Tommy.
And I'm J-Dog with the... Big dump in the penis bump.
Yeah.
We can restart if you want.
No. No, you put that on record. That's there forever.
Clean take. Josh.
Josh Kane, you're in like three bands. Tell us about them.
I like them. And the first one, we'll go in chronological order. Pretty pleased. From back from 2016, I think. That's my baby. And I have been hired to play in OK Cool. I'm strictly an employee. There is no joy.
That sounds awful.
I wish you could understand.
I don't want to.
Maybe one day, young man. And then Pulitzer Priceless is the latest and greatest, just released the first song on Spotify. It's a good song.
It's a good song. I'll say that into the microphone.
It's how you say headbang-ish and...
Headbang-ish?
Headbang-ish.
Cool.
Having capabilities of hanging bed. Banging heads. I will end my turn.
Great. And Josh, you're here to share a film with us. Can you tell us about that film, your connection with it, what it means to you, your life story?
So we are discussing Love and Mercy. That's Love, ampersand, Mercy. And I saw it in theaters when it came out with, I believe, just my parents. I don't know if my sister came, but I assume my dad knew about Beach Boys because he likes music, and also my mom likes music, now that I talk about it. So she must know about it.
Two for two.
Both parents, they know music. And I hadn't heard of the movie before going in. And then it just quickly became an all-time favorite. I don't buy a lot of media, but this one I bought the Blu-ray, I think full price. Back when Best Buy sold physical media.
Which you're not going to do next year.
Not going to do it.
We should talk about that. We're not going to, though. Oh. I do have a couple follow-up questions about your Love and Mercy and Beach Boys experience. First one, was this like instant favorite movie, or did it take a couple watches? What was the like immediate reaction?
I don't remember. Okay. Other than really liking it coming out of the theater.
Okay.
I think as my musical hobbies or interests greatened over the years, I started to connect with the movie a little bit more, with like mental health. I mean, medication is not like super talked about in the movie, but it's like one of the main main driving points of conflict, and just how the two are, in fact, very related, music and mental health. And I was like, yeah, this is a good representation of that, and it's beautiful.
Yeah. And then were you already like a Beach Boys fan, or has this made you more of a Beach Boys fan? Because I'm curious about your history with like the band too.
This made me a little bit more of a Beach Boys fan. I listen to Pet Sounds whenever I watch the movie, and then don't touch it until the next time. But just cause it's fresh on the mind, obviously, but, I think I connect more with the story than the actual Beach Boys music. I connect with the process of Brian Wilson making the music. But yeah, I always thought the Beach Boys were like sun and surfing and girls, maybe. I don't know. I think they talk about boys, too. So, yeah, this was eye-opening for Beach Boys history.
Yeah, what an interesting... I, like, got sucked into a vortex of Beach Boys stuff today, specifically. Because I mean, I really liked Pet Sounds, and my brother really put me onto the Beach Boys when I was a little younger, and specifically, like, this kind of, like, branch of their story, and, like, the Smile kind of, like, mythology. And he's like, you gotta hear this song, Vegetables. It's crazy. And then, yeah, this came around. I remember it coming out and was really excited for it, but I didn't see it until, like, 2020. And I kind of forgot about it, but it was a delight to rewatch, and it's a fantastic film.
You saying vegetables makes me want to cut directly into the middle of the movie when we just see in the recording studio all the tapes of I think they were like,
yeah,
what do you call them?
It was like analog
tapes. Analog tapes, yeah. And they all had labels on the spine, and there was like hundreds of them. And there was a close-up or pretty close-up shot of just panning through the labels, and I was like, haha, there's one called Vegetables. And then it kept panning, and they're like, hey, there are two more. And then it kept going, and there was like five more at that point. So that was the first song I listened to when I pulled up, Smile.
I was listening to Smile as well this past week, and I remember looking at the credits on Wikipedia, and it was like vegetable chomping next to like every Beach Boys name for the credits on the album. I thought that was fantastic.
Every band needs a vegetable chomper.
Every band needs a vegetable chomper. Who, in each of your three bands, who are the vegetable chompers at the top of your head? Go.
Well, I'm a vegetarian, so...
So you by default for all of them?
Yes. Yes.
That was an easy answer then. Glad I came up with that on the spot.
I think something that's particularly remarkable about this movie is the fact that you see music composition and engineering in like such thorough detail. Yeah. Like not a lot of movies, if any, really have like seeing a musician come up with an idea for a song and like kind of like building it out. And I think the stuff in the studio doing Pet Sounds is so much fun to watch because you're like, he's playful and he's like having a great time. So that's good. but he's also like, It adds this whole dimension to an album, which at least for me was something I felt very familiar with. And then like I didn't realize that like, you know, putting the pins on the piano strings and the ideas of like them playing different bass lines and different keys, mm-hmm. and like all that kind of like minutia that kind of definitely gives you like a new appreciation for that music.
Yeah,
it just gives me an appreciation for like quote unquote back in the day when they actually recorded things in studios. I just kept thinking the whole time during those scenes, like, oh, I do this in my bedroom and don't have access to like he makes a reference to playing the studio itself as like another instrument. That's just something like so lost on me that I'd never considered. And I was like, holy shit, that is the coolest thing I've ever heard in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Brian Wilson, you're on to something.
You're gifted, kid.
As Hal. Hal, whatever. Hal? I have a note about somewhere.
Al Jardine.
No, that's one of the Beach Boys. It was one of the session musicians who was like, you got something special, kid.
So great point I've accidentally made. A qualm I have with the movie is the exposition of specifically the band members. Anyone but the main characters, like I had no idea who they were. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that maybe their names were spoken once. But like the rest of the Beach Boys all had the same mop top haircut and
yeah.
I didn't know who was who. Thoughts on that?
There's like one scene where it's like, oh, sorry. I'm talking in the wrong part of the microphone. I am an audio engineer at heart. There's like the scene at the beginning where they're in the press conference when it's doing like the sort of good old days montage and they kind of really quickly go, Brian, other people's Dennis, names. I'm Carl. Dennis, yeah. Carl, thank you. Beach Boys. I'm a big fan, as you can tell. I actually don't know a lot about the Beach Boys.
I will say that's up front. Me neither.
Yeah. And I like was doing some research, but I just like learned I'm not like a Beach Boys guy. Mm-hmm. I'm a Beatles guy. And everything I know about the Beach Boys was like related back to their kind of competitiveness with the Beatles, which was referenced in the movie, which I thought was funny. Mm-hmm. They talk about Rubber Soul a good amount, which I thought was cool. And then Paul McCartney saying he likes God Only Knows, I think is the one that he said was like one of the greatest songs. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's like, that was neat. But that was like the only frame of reference I've ever had for the Beach Boys. And I'd seen this movie probably when it came out and just didn't remember much about it. So it was cool kind of getting a refresher course, not just in how good the movie is, but just like the Beach Boys as a band that exists that I forgot about.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a nice little reminder because I went back and listened to Pet Sounds and still not like fully my cup of tea, but I had a new appreciation for it. Just kind of understanding Brian Wilson a little better, where he was coming from with some of that competitiveness and then just wanting to try weird new things.
Mm-hmm.
Does he go over the top, a little too over the top sometimes? I think so, but that's just a personal aesthetic sort of not movie related note.
There are a lot of pieces of the movie that are exaggerated or just completely not true, but for the sake of the movie. One of the main things, they show Melinda basically leaving a voicemail for Carl, getting the ball rolling for, you know, suing Dr. Landy for all of his garbage he did. Mm-hmm. But it turns out that it was Brian's therapist who did that, who got the ball rolling in real life.
Something on Wikipedia that I read today about that was that it was also partially because of Landy's like monthly salary going up to like $30,000 a month, which I guess in the 80s is like $100,000 or something.
Who was paying him?
I assume that Brian Wilson fund the
estate.
I don't think it's an estate until you die, but okay. I'm not a lawyer. Okay. This is not a legal podcast. Do not take any legal advice. Not yet. Yeah, I think, you know, and to your point about the exposition and the other band members and stuff. So I had like a pretty basic understanding of it going in, and I, after like doing a lot of reading today, I kind of like was able to put it all in place of who is who. Because like there's also those, there's those other guys that they hang out with who are like helping him write songs, like not explained at all. No. But like the it's like Carl and Dennis Wilson, his brothers, and then Mike Love. And Mike Love is kind of a I think Beach Boys fans kind of, you know, mostly paint him as the big villain of their career. But a lot of stuff I was reading today was kind of like, yeah, he wasn't actually that mad about it. He was just, you know, pushing back. He didn't understand it, whatever. And then there's Al Jardine, who, frankly, I don't know if he had a line in this movie. If he did, like, I was on, like, there's just another guy in the band. Because it mostly focused on the brothers and Mike Love. And then, yeah, there was those other songwriters and stuff that were, like, floating around. There's a guy named, like, Dyke Van Park or something like that.
Never even heard those words.
Yeah, I know, right? But he's in that, like, he's in the movie. I can't place him. He's the guy that was supposed to be helping Brian write Smile. And I think there's that scene where they kind of like, the Beach Boys kind of like break up kind of in the pool. And Brian's kind of like floating around on a pool floaty. And it's that guy who's like on the edge of the pool. Yeah. Who's like, I've been writing songs forever or whatever.
He looks 14 years old. And I was like, yeah. You have not been writing songs forever, dude. You're 14 years old.
Towards the like beginning, middle, I think like, so you would consider it first act. Tyson Ritter was one of his friends.
I don't know which one that is.
I can't describe his appearance too well other than like long hair. He's the singer of All American Rejects.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
I did not clock that.
So I was like really distracted by that. I don't know if that scene, there was...
Oh, okay. I know who you're talking about now. Yeah. I looked up a picture of him. He's just like, there's those two guys who are just like, yeah, Brian, man, you go... Go do your thing.
You know, you're the band, like that.
Yeah. At the dinner party. He was there.
There's a couple of those like yes men guys that are always hanging out with him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then
didn't get a name.
No, probably not.
No name.
He was All American, uncredited.
Mm-hmm. Actually, he's credited, and the other guy is Hipster One and Hipster Two.
Really?
Yep.
Nice. I read a lot of stuff about Brian Wilson's life between Pet Sounds and Smile, and then to the point where, you know, we kind of pick up with the John Cusack part. John Cusack, Chicago, Evanston native.
I saw him at a Cubs game once.
He's a fan. His stunt double is like a regular at G-Man. He's a guy. He like kind of looks like John. He doesn't look like very much like him, honestly. But
it's okay. John Cusack also doesn't look like Brian Wilson, so
that's true. I will say I think Paul Dano does look like Brian Wilson.
That's a good casting.
But John Cusack, great performance. We'll get to it.
Oh yeah.
So he did a lot of like they let the other Beach Boys just like take over the brand, and they made a ton of albums where Brian just kind of floated in and out of contributing, and like some of them he kind of did a little bit more, and some of them he like literally wasn't there, which is really bizarre. But I guess he just like kind of further drifted into that like, you know, drug addled like depressive, you know, whatever, psychotic break or whatever, you know, was going on with him. Mm-hmm. But they were active in making stuff like for basically all of the 70s too, which was really surprising to me. The movie kind of makes it feel like after Smile, they broke up, and then, they picked us up. But I think that's all in the, you know, name of like having a really good story.
For me, the, timeline of Beach Boys, like specifically Beach Boys stuff, is unclear to me. Mm-hmm. The timeline of like Brian Wilson stuff, including like making music and then in the 80s time, that timeline's good. But like, do you think that the makers of the film and the consultants didn't think that the Beach Boys specifically stuff was not like as important, but like wasn't worth mentioning?
I don't know if it's that so much as it's not like a movie about the Beach Boys.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of where I came at it from, because there are definitely, yeah, lots of holes and just confusing things with, I didn't leave it understanding more about the Beach Boys really understood it. I left it understanding more about Brian Wilson. I think that was more the point.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is okay. I think that was a good choice. It would have been hard to kind of give too much context and have it feel like a history lesson. Like they do the little montage during the opening credits, and I think that's enough to just be like, this is a band that exists, but you probably already know about them enough to appreciate what's going on.
I really liked that opening credits montage.
I remember the first time I saw it feeling disoriented. The first like 10 minutes or so of the movie, the editing, I was just like, what is going on? Is the whole movie gonna feel like this?
Yeah,
it's like him in the studio talking to himself, and then he's in bed, and it's black, and then it's the montage, and it's Back to the Future, and I'm like, I don't understand where I'm supposed to be right now. And I got really worried the whole movie was gonna be that sort of like weird expressionistic editing style. It like finds its pacing, but
yeah,
I find the beginning of this movie very disorienting, which is maybe the point, but I thought, I was like, please don't all be like this.
Yeah,
that opening montage kicks ass. I was like so into that.
Yeah
I want to see a whole documentary about the Beach Boys, like entire career. That was something actually that I walked away from, but I understood that it was a Brian Wilson movie about, mm-hmm, Brian Wilson's like, you know, struggles and identity and vibe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I thought it was great pacing the whole time.
Yes.
I wanted the portrayals of mental health, such as like the way they tried to portray his anxiety, like the dinner table with all like the silverware clinking and getting more and more, and like that's a great thing, or like a great portrayal.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was itching for it to be more subtle in a way that's not, I don't know, that's just like a picky,
I don't know. I get what you're saying in terms of it not being very subtle. And I think I had that thought at one point, specifically with the sound design during that dinner table scene, and kind of also when he's on the plane having the panic attack at the beginning. They do a similar thing.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, I'm like, there's nothing subtle about a panic attack. So I think it kind of worked for me.
Yeah. The score, that was the first thing I wrote down, Atticus Ross. I was like, this is going to be good.
Nice.
And it always comes through.
No, but I had some notes about the score, because I went back and forth on, not if I liked it, I liked the score. The score does this weird thing where parts of it sound very contemporary and how it kind of remixes different parts of Beach Boys songs. Mm-hmm. And I think that makes sense in the context of the 80s scenes, kind of like ghosts of the past, like just kind of like the haunting voices of the ooze from and harmonies of Beach Boys songs.
Yeah.
Makes sense to me. But it did sound very, like when they did kind of add the score to the 60s scenes, it felt kind of anachronistic in a way where I was like, just play the Beach Boys songs. They're doing the Beach Boys songs. Like I was fine with that and thought it made sense because the score would come in for those parts. And I was like, it just sounds very modern for like what's taking place. I liked the score. But sometimes in context, I was like, this sounds a little modern, but it made more sense to sound modern, I guess, in the 80s than when like the look of the film when they're in the 60s is completely different from the look of the film when they're in the 80s. Like aesthetically, they do a good job separating the two, but the score was kind of consistent through both.
I think the score stands out to me because he's doing the remixing of the harmonies of the vocal harmonies. And then what stuck in my head at this moment is when Brian Wilson's dad comes into the studio and he's like, I just signed this band, put on this record. Yeah. This is what a gold record sounds like. Or he's like, Brian, come listen to what a gold record sounds like. And it's the song Sun, Sun, Sun. And then it's like a really building rhythmic, like boom, 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 yeah. boom, boom. That's stuck in my head right now. But like the way it was mixed into the score and then kind of turned into like a heartbeat while we're focused on Brian in the recording room, separated from the music and the people. It just like he tuned it out is what I got. And then he came back to like internal thoughts and internal ideas. That reminds me of an earlier scene where his dad comes into the studio and he's like, or it might have been the same scene. Cause yeah, he's like, I signed this new band. And Brian Wilson goes, that's great, Dad. That's good for you. You're doing your own thing. And I was like, well, obviously like that's a great response. But he's able to like not worry about the competition is the vibe I got from that. He's able to compartmentalize.
Yeah, but it's also like a band doing a completely different thing than he's trying to do at that point. Because I don't think, and the whole conflict between Mike and Brian kind of illustrates this. Brian's not out to make a gold record anyway at that point. He just wants to, I mean, not beat the Beatles, but, you know, do something experimental and different and interesting. But it was cool how calm he was in response to his dad just like being an asshole.
Mm-hmm.
I do want to talk about the dad's role in the movie a little bit, because I thought, let me find my note. I guess so. I wrote this note like half an hour into the movie, and I just was wondering about what his role was and whether it was necessary to have him be such like explicitly a character in the movie versus something more talked about. Cause like Brian's got so much shit going on and the dad's just such an over the top one dimensional like asshole character. And I get that he might've actually been like that. And I understand like the parallels between him and then Dr. Landy later in the movie, but like, it just felt kind of obvious in a way that, I don't know. I feel like there's a way to maybe do it more subtly than just here's the dad being a jerk and then pushing it in your face, I guess. I don't really know how to phrase it well.
The wrong kid died.
The wrong kid died.
Was that said?
No, Dan and I watched Walk Hard this week.
Yeah.
And there's a running bit where the dad keeps saying the wrong kid died.
Jeez.
But honestly, I kind of got that vibe a little bit where the dad's just so... Like, I think they could have done without him because there's already the scene with him and Melissa at the restaurant later where they're talking about like the dad beating him as a kid and stuff. I feel like
I wrote something for that exact thing.
Yeah, go for it.
That stood out to me. He's like, my dad scared me as a kid, and he scared me into, or I think he scared me into making good records.
Yeah, that line's wild.
Mm-hmm.
I think that does enough of the lifting that you don't have to like keep coming back to the dad in the past scenes, I guess is my point.
Mm-hmm.
Like that line alone, I was like, I get it.
The scene with like the flashback of him hitting young Brian.
Yeah.
That could have been the only thing we saw of the dad.
Yeah, and I would have been like,
that's what you're saying.
Yeah, got it.
Good point.
I don't actually have much of a problem with that character. I mean, I think, like, yeah, he's pretty, you know, he's got one mode. But I think, yeah, obviously, you're meant to connect it with, like, why would he let Landy treat him that way? And you're kind of like, oh, well, you know, it kind of is, you know, this complex in his head that comes from his father's abuse. And then also like a little bit like Mike Love too is kind of like another guy who's like pushing him around all the time and, and like doubting him. And I guess it's like to really dig into all the complexities of his relationship with his father, like probably needed another half an hour in this movie or something. But yeah, I think a lot of stuff, not unlike the, those sort of like timeline differences and things, I think are just made at the expense of just trying to tell the story as like effectively and simply as possible. And I feel like the dad is a part of that too.
I think I know the answer for Tommy, but do you think there are too many villains, Dan? With Gene and Mike Love and the dad.
I mean, it's a tragic story and about someone kind of overcoming a lot. The thing that you're taught in film school is in screenwriting, you need to place as many obstacles as possible in the way of your protagonist. Because,
really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like, the idea is that because, you know, watching someone overcome a lot of stuff is entertaining and inspiring and, you know, compelling to connect with. They have to do that otherwise, you know, because otherwise, like in other cases, when you think about movies where, like, there's no conflicts and things just kind of like, it's not engaging.
Ted Lasso. How do they do it?
There's plenty of conflicts in Ted Lasso.
There's either few or minor conflicts and they get away with it and it's great. That's also why they'll never let Spider-Man marry Mary Jane in the comics.
Because it's a big thing he has to overcome.
Because they think no conflict in a comic book won't sell. So they keep the conflict of like, will they, won't they?
So it's not enough that a giant green goblin is trying to kill him?
No, never.
Okay.
That's why he has so many villains.
This is blowing my mind. I don't know how I feel about this as many conflicts as possible thing.
Well,
obstacles, not conflicts. Sorry.
Yeah. Well, that's stories are conflict. It is. It something has to prevent something from happening for things to happen. You know what I mean? Like it's like you have to have barriers, otherwise there is nothing to like happen. There's no story. There's no action.
Yes.
Yeah, you're right, Dan.
You are correct. Let's stop the podcast. Just as many as possible. One compelling obstacle isn't enough. And then just really honing in on like the psychology around why that's an obstacle.
It's not just like on a macro level. It's obstacles are, you know, I don't know. There should be a conflict and a resolution in like every scene. You know, like every, like, I'm not talking just about like there should be three villains, like Spider-Man, for example. In the Spider-Man movies, they used to like, I'm thinking about Tobey Maguire because that's
sure.
That's my,
mm-hmm.
That's the correct one. Yeah. those movies would have like two or three major villains that were all a part of the same thing. And I think that's actually, personally, I just think that's good writing because it gives you a lot of clay to play with as far as storytelling.
Pun intended. Clayface.
Clay.
Oh, shoot. That's DC.
No.
Delete it.
Josh works for a comic book store, I think.
I love comics. There goes my card.
But like, you know, if it's, I don't know. I just think that it's all about making things complex and difficult. And I think you raise the risk, you raise the reward, you create higher stakes. I think in Brian Wilson's case, it's like, not only is he fighting people, he's also fighting some things about himself. He's fighting the Beatles.
Yeah. So I would love to see a fight.
Yeah, dude. A like Brian fight. Wilson like suplexes Paul McCartney.
Josh, who'd win in a fight, Paul McCartney or Brian Wilson?
Spider-Man.
So anyway, this is all to tell you that we're working on our new Spider-Man, Brian Wilson, and Paul McCartney comic. Yeah. I don't mean it like literally, like I think you could have too many like literal villains in a movie, but I don't know. Comparatively, Mike Love is more of a resistant force than he is like, you know, a primary villain.
Yeah.
That emphasizes certain aspects of, you know, the story.
I have a note that says Mike Love makes some good points. And I felt bad writing it, but I was like, I get he's supposed to kind of be a bad guy stifling the creativity. But like I get it.
Are you gonna mention the cellos?
No, I loved that scene
when he was like,
so
"They've
much.
Been doing it for 2 hours."
Yeah. Like that was a good point, but like, it's not that I agree with him. It's more I get where he's coming from in terms of like that we need a hit thing. Like it's the fucking Beach Boys, but I do love that like the scene afterwards is them writing "Good Vibrations," which is like their last big hit for a long time, if not their last big hit.
That when they were figuring it out, and Mike was like pointing at Brian, like, "Yeah, you got something. This is something." That struck me as like the first time he was ever like, affirming anything Brian did or said.
I think to continue our discussion of storytelling mechanics, I think that it's always important that like the best kind of villains are people that have like, you know, believable cause, and right. I think he does. It's not always illustrated super clearly because, like, you know, he makes the point, like, when they're listening to Pet Sounds, he's like, I'm trying to make hits, you know, like, I want to, like, there's not a single on this record, or, you know, stuff like that. And, like, you know, honestly, that's, you're right, Mike Love makes some good points. Like, if that was going to destroy their career, it didn't. And then I don't think the album was a big success either, so, like, at the time. So he was right. But we didn't get like a lot of him. It was just that line of him saying, I don't hear a single, which is like, you know, classic music bad guy. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, he does make good points. Yeah, the cellos thing comes at a time when, you know, we're supposed to be kind of just seeing how Brian is, you know, I don't know, losing it because of his desire to create the masterpiece.
Yeah.
I listened to the Smile Sessions today. I don't know if it was working. That's my opinion.
We're happy for him.
Yeah, you know, I appreciate it, you know.
It's like when you after you play a show with a band, you say, when someone asks how are the other bands? You say they were very nice.
The Smile Sessions is a very nice album.
Yeah, they were cool.
My memory of the Smile Session is I remember when that came out, I think I was like, I don't remember what year the Smile Session like CD came out, if you can look it up, Dan. But I remember when it came out, I was like at my youth group, and there was a guy there who ran audio that was like, this is the greatest thing that's like ever been released. And I was like, what? He's like, the Beach Boys, like Smile Session, Brian Wilson's masterpiece, like was like fully bought into it and telling me all about how I need to listen to the Smile Sessions. And I remember going home, listening to it, and as like a, what year did it come out?
2011. But then there was also a one release under Brian Wilson's name that's just called Smile.
That's the one I listened to.
From 2004.
But it had like a similar track list.
I listened to the Smile Sessions by the Beach Boys from 2011 is what I listened to. And what the guy was raving about in my youth group for some reason. And I didn't get it. And I felt dumb for not getting it because this was a guy I thought was very cool. And he was like older than me and had tattoos. So
oh, man.
He was cool and I wasn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. Brian Wilson also released an album called Smile in 2004. That is like the same track list. But I'm sure there are different things. And I think there's like really expansive releases of all these things that have all kinds of like clips and things.
Yeah. No, I know that, like the box set for the Smile Sessions is like very comprehensive, but I only listened to like what was considered the actual album.
Mm-hmm. The one I listened, or some of the ones I listened to, were like they had multiple titles, like one title slash another title,
like medleys.
But yeah, but also they didn't work together.
No,
there were some with like abrupt changes, different keys, different tempos. They just seemed like a journal. And they're like, they finally released Anne Frank's diary.
But it's only certain pages.
Yeah.
There's a song on the Beach Boys version, and it's just titled differently on the Brian Wilson version, but on the Beach Boys one, it's called The Elements, Fire, parentheses, Mrs. O'Leary's Cow. And I'm like, dude, what were we doing? The 60s were nuts. Which, you know, that's a Chicago reference, Mrs. O'Leary's Cow.
Oh, I was going to ask.
Yeah.
The cow who kicked over the... You're a St. Louis person, so I guess.
So am I.
Right.
For those of you who couldn't see me do the over my head gesture, I just did the over my head gesture.
Cow kicked over a lamp, well, like the one where you actually use fire. And that started the Chicago Fire.
Oh. But it does seem like... If you're titling a song like that, The Elements, colon, Fire, like there was clearly like maybe a day where he was like, we should do The Elements, Water, The Elements, Earth. It's going to be awesome.
He was watching Avatar, The Last Airbender.
I was going to say he was like pre-Sufjan Stevens doing all 50 states and giving up after two.
There's a scene that was not funny when I was watching it, but in hindsight, I think is really funny, is when he's in the studio and he's like, we got to cancel. The vibes are off. It's sad, but like in concept, he said the vibes are off.
The feeling of too far gone.
yeah,
kind of came up for me in that moment. And also for Eugene, when I think it was the Arnold Palmer scene.
That's when he's like saying like you have to not see him anymore.
Yes, yeah. And Melinda brought matzo ball soup, like, yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely adorable. And he's like, no, and then he puts it in the trash. I'm like, there might have been redemption for him somewhere along the way, except or like until right now. I was like, the villain is too far gone.
Yeah, he's. I would argue that maybe he's more one-dimensional, not as one-dimensional as the dad, but like a great performance from Giamatti. Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Everyone is good in this movie.
Everyone.
I was thinking about, at first it was like, who is better, Paul Dano or John Cusack, which I don't think is fair because they're doing two very different things that still work together really effectively, even though they don't look alike and like, but just those two different points in his life, like, I buy it. I buy it's the same guy. And I didn't think I would when I started watching it. But by the end, I was like, the through lines just made sense. I think that was because their performances were just so committed and pitch perfect in their separate regards. I mean, I thought they both did fantastic jobs.
I read that they weren't allowed to talk throughout the production of the movie.
Oh, wow.
To just keep them separate.
I would have assumed the exact opposite. That they were, like, giving each other notes.
I don't know if I support it, but it was just weird.
I'm not really into that. I was like, for me, I do think that they come from totally different eras. So like the stories and the way that they're shot. And so I feel like the performances are a little disconnected for me, especially, but you know, he's in totally different places in his life. I think the John Cusack one is really understated. In a really impressive way, and I think the Paul Dano one is so much more, like, it's bigger and I mean there's more going on, so like as far as action goes,
oh yeah, that fight scene was crazy,
that part where he fucked up Paul McCartney. I feel like you should have let those guys, like, decide on, like, even like, you know, like little, you know, physical cues or something. Right. I suppose that, like, what they were going for was, like, yeah, they should be pretty separate because they're in completely different parts of, you know, his life, and he's going through such different things. And he's like, the Pet Sounds version of Brian is a completely different person than John Cusack Brian.
No, I mean, I just read it as, at that point, John Cusack just had the life beat out of him, is how I read it, why it was so different. But I assume they were talking to each other about those sorts of decisions. So that's surprising.
Before we take an ad break, we did not talk about the cocktail.
Oh, I'll talk about it. So we do a cocktail every episode, as listeners know. So this is not an original cocktail for this episode. It is called the Beach Bum. It is a recipe from a bartender named John Darragon from Please Don't Tell, a bar in New York, who named it after Jeff Beachbum Barry, who was famous for inventing and recreating many famous and historic tiki recipes.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff. Jeff apparently wrote like tons of books just about tiki cocktails, and I want to get some because it sounds super fun. But the Beachbum, what I used to make it, Probitas White Rum, Havana Club Dark Rum, Apricot Liqueur, Luxardo Maraschino Liqueur instead of Orgeau because I'm allergic to it because I'm a wimp, pineapple juice, which Dan hand juiced himself. Strenuously. Dan didn't get pineapple juice, but bought chunks of pineapple and juiced them, which was so impressive and cool. And then lime juice. And it is a tiki drink. It's called the Beach Bum. And that is also a word in the name of the band the main character of this movie is in.
And it sounds like this. It's an audio medium. You gotta give audio.
They can't see the cocktails. Clues. They have to hear it. You're right. Yeah. We should do more SMR. Is that what it's called?
ASMR.
God damn.
ASL.
Last time I didn't know what eating without YouTube was, and I don't know what ASMR is. I'm on the internet. I don't know why I'm just missing things. It's a very good cocktail.
I like it.
I'm glad. Josh doesn't like a ton of cocktails.
I'm very snooty.
Yeah.
/ uncultured.
I don't think it's either of those. You like what you like, and I respect it.
Also, you can see how much I've drank so far is not a lot compared to yours.
I just drink a lot of cocktails. In like a fun, healthy, flirty way.
And I'm thirsty.
Dan's just thirsty.
I'm working with a new cocktail now. The cocktail to make gold records. It's a reference to the movie Love and Mercy, which we are discussing currently.
And we're back. Thanks to Squarespace for sponsoring.
I wanted to mention the director. So really, I was really curious because I was like, who did this? And because I think it's an extremely well-directed movie, great performances. I think, yeah, like that opening montage is great. Like the scene in the car dealership is incredible. I just think in general, like really, really well-directed movie. So the director is a man named Bill Pollard. Pollard.
There's no N?
No.
I've been saying Poland.
Bill Poland? I like that more, frankly. Change it. But he probably shouldn't change it because what I learned about Bill Pollard is... Bill Pollard is the son of Mary Eloise and billionaire financier Carl Pollard, who owned the Minnesota Twins from 1984 until 2009. His brother Jim then took over as owner. And their other brother is the owner of Northmark Capital. So they got some money. And so he directed something in 1990 called Old Explorers, which I couldn't find a lot of information about. And then came back in a film in 2005, exec producer on Brokeback Mountain. And produced produced like a bunch of other like sort of Oscar-y stuff. Produced 12 Years a Slave, so that would mean he has the Best Picture Oscar. Wow. And then this was his first thing that he directed since that movie in 1990, and has since directed only one movie, Dreamin' Wild, which actually I'm really excited to watch because it's are you familiar? If you're familiar with the Donnie and Joe Emerson. These are brothers that recorded an album in the 70s, and it was like this like long lost gem, and it was like picked up again. But it's a movie about them, starring Casey Affleck and Zooey Deschanel. Seems like it's going to have similar vibes to Love and Mercy. So kind of a weird niche little thing.
Little guy.
Yeah, he's a little guy. A
niche little guy. I watched a little after special feature. Given the privilege of a Blu-ray disc, you should try it.
Check it out. But Blu-rays. You're not going to be able to buy them soon.
He looked like a music industry guy. He had like long hair. I don't know how this is relevant, but
it doesn't have to be.
He seems like a guy who cares about music. And I don't know. You would just see this guy on stage with Brian Wilson if you saw him.
Well, even just, I mean, this is more common, I guess, about the entire crew and maybe Paul Dano specifically. Like, how Paul, as Brian Wilson, talks about music, like, checks out. Like, I don't know if that was the screenwriting or Paul doing his homework or what, but when he was in the studio just, like, giving musicians instructions, I was like, that's a real thing you would say to a musician to, like, get them to do. Like, I was really, really impressed with that.
I couldn't tell what was him doing his homework or just, like, a well-remembered line.
Right.
But he was actually playing God Only Knows at the beginning.
Yes. I clocked he was actually playing piano because I don't think John Cusack was, but Paul was. And I thought that was awesome. Mm-hmm. And watching his fingers reminded me of how cool chord inversions are and how I never use them. And I remember one of the notes I took was just, where was it? Something about how I just want to use more chord inversions. And Paul Dano, watching him play that song, I was like, oh yeah, that's a really easy way to just like add harmonic intrigue to something. And I forgot that like existed because I haven't taken AP music theory in a lot of years.
Mm-hmm. I liked how raw that scene was, how raw that performance on piano was. You could see him like trying to figure out the chord for a second. And,
yeah.
And it was like the audience's entrance into what it's like to write a song, what it's like to, I mean, even just show a person the song for the first time.
Immediately giving like 20 disclaimers about how it isn't done. Like, I feel that.
Yeah. Yeah. But, and then getting shut down.
Yeah. Again, like I said earlier, you know, my brother kind of put me on to the Beach Boys and specifically, you know, this album. And, you know, like one of the like earliest, you know, one of the main things I heard about it was Paul McCartney said God Only Knows is one of the best songs ever written. And I remember listening to Pet Sounds, you know, really early on and being like, I don't see what the big deal is. And then I tried to learn to play God Only Knows on guitar. And I was like, what are these?
Those inversions.
I was like, what are these chords?
I attempted it. It's on my Instagram if you want to see. I used a capo.
Oh, yeah. So I listened to Pet Sounds this morning. It is a not, it's a pretty ugly day outside. And I think that it's a perfect album for a little seasonal depresh, which is nice. I personally, as much as I respect and appreciate all the musicianship, I actually just really like the lyrics in the songs. I think that it's an incredibly sad album. Mm-hmm. Like even like the like, you know, Wouldn't It Be Nice, which is kind of like simple, fun song about like, we should live together. It's so much time. And then I kind of realized at the end he says, I mean, we could talk about it, you know, we should just talk about it. It was not like, there's kind of this unresolved thing at the end. It's
a happy sounding song.
They all are. They just are like,
well, the dad literally calls God Only Knows a suicide note. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Stop being so mean and right.
Also, yeah, sad. I like sad. I don't know. It's more interesting. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Wilson would have hated all of our friends' bands.
It's no wonder that it wasn't a hit at the time. It's not accessible except for the hits. And that's what his dad was pushing for. That's what Mike was pushing for, is hits and accessibility. But the if I could pull out one line from this entire movie, it's Brian saying, I can't sing about sun and cars and surfing and sun and surfing and cars. I think he repeats one of them.
Yeah.
I have other stuff in me. I got to get it out.
Well, that's one of the crazy things, though, is like, I think God Only Knows is way more accessible than like singing about I get around and dad took the T-Bird. Like,
mm-hmm.
People feel that way. Like, that's amazing. We should talk about that. I don't know. I love that song so much.
Yeah.
Do you guys want to hear my favorite line from the movie?
Absolutely.
It is from, I already forgot the name of the guy that's like helping Brian write songs. I think he says it.
For I can't picture this guy you're talking about.
I think the guy who helps him write Pet Sounds?
There's Smile, I think. Oh. It's later in the movie.
Because there, I think that's Dyke Van Park. I think
that's maybe that's who it is. The line is, he's defending Brian after Mike says the lyrics don't make any sense. And he says, the album's a gothic cowboy trip. The lyrics don't matter. I don't think anybody in any movie ever has ever understood my songwriting philosophy more than that man in that moment.
One more time.
It's a gothic cowboy trip. The lyrics don't matter.
Gothic cowboy
and
trip.
And I said, hell yeah.
I looked it up. His name is Van Dyke Parks. Sorry. Sorry, man.
Do you have a picture of his character? Or is it just going to be another mop top boy?
There's a lot of pictures of parks, unfortunately. Hold on.
A park named after Dick Van Dyke.
And then they named a guy after it. I mean, only scene I can think of that he's like even in is where he's like sitting on the edge of the pool. And he's
that
like,
was the scene I think they said that line.
Yeah, yeah.
So he kind of like a darker skin, and he had like a... His pants rolled up, and then he got up, and then
yes.
His butt was wet. Let's do that to
ass
me.
Man.
Oh, no. Okay. I just found a meme image. I was like, oh, here's a picture of him as a young person, and it's a picture of, I think, fucking car seat headrest, and it says, am I right?
That's the guy. I thought it was... can cut this skin description part.
Yeah, there he is. See, he's that's the real guy.
Well, it's 14. That's what I was saying earlier.
Yeah.
He said he was writing songs since he was 14.
I said he looks.
And that's
14.
Him now.
Or, no, it's not.
No, he's dead. Sorry. Anyway,
you guys, you should see these pictures.
You guys gotta see it. Fucking pictures. I listened to a bunch of I listened to Smile today. I listened to the album that was, because I remember listening to their stuff and thinking that even the albums a little bit before Pet Sounds did have some stuff that was a little progressive. So I listened to one, the Beach Boys, Today, Isn't it great how 60s albums, like, they have one called Hot Summer Days and then parentheses and nights exclamation point. But yeah, their stuff was still pretty much kind of I get around type stuff. And then later on, I listened to one from 77, which I guess is actually after the Landy era. And it's like a bunch of synth instruments. They're like 2 minute songs that have like these like synth bass lines. And
77 or 87?
77.
Wow.
And it sounds wacky. I was like, it's been described as their synth punk album. It's not. Ooh. Don't let that fool you.
So excited.
Don't let that fool you, because I like it's kind of worth a listen. It's called The Beach Boys Love You.
It was. I don't know. I'm sorry. It was annoying. Like the annoying parts of the Beach Boys come through a lot post Pet Sounds.
Like the parts that are just like there's the one that I remember from this album. From earlier is called Mona. It's like, Mona, come on, girl. Like, I'm just like, ah, man, I don't. Sun and cars and girls.
So I've never tried LSD, and this is one of those times where I don't think I want to, but sometimes I watch these movies about like Brian Wilson, or like watch the old Beatles, like Yellow Submarine or Magical Mystery Tour or something, and I'm just like, does it make you better at music? And I don't know. I don't know what I'm asking right now, but I just have a note that says this movie kind of makes me want to try LSD and also makes me never want to try LSD. That's solely based on the scene where Brian just breaks down crying after he talks to his wife about his first experience with it, where he's like, I saw God, and then just starts weeping.
I saw the future. I'm so, so sorry.
Yes. Terrifying line.
I'm wondering if he, what he saw.
Yeah. I mean, I'm probably not going to do it.
He saw the Beach Boys synth punk album. Roasted.
Take that, Brian Wilson, you fucking hack. You made a synth punk.
You've been roasted by the D-Man. Boing.
We need more sound effects cued into this.
I got you.
I'll plug in vegetables here.
Vegetables. Can
just
you play it?
Chomping.
We're listening to the whole song, everybody. Tune in. Strap in. I'm gonna be round my vegetables. I'm gonna chop down my vegetables. I love you most of all. All right, for context, we're gonna skip to the like halfway through. We get that brushing your teeth like crazy part. So that's what happens when you take LSD.
See, I kind of want my own vegetables.
You could do it. I believe in you.
I'm sure I could do it sober. I'm not going to do LSD. But every time I watch one of these movies, or even Walk Hard, where they have the LSD trip Brian Wilson scene of him doing like his parody of Pet Sounds, like, I'm just like, it could be cool.
You don't want none of this.
You don't want none of this shit.
So the in conclusion, walk hard is the best movie.
Walk Hard is the best movie.
I gotta rewatch that.
It's so good. I watch that like every couple of months when I'm just like feeling down. I'm like, I need to watch Walk Hard, and it immediately makes me feel better. But we're not talking about Walk Hard. We're talking about Love and Mercy. That was my transition back into the topic.
Speaking of talking about Love and Mercy. We said the movie was beautiful. I noticed a lot more of, like one takes than a standard biopic or, I mean, any movie. It was just like,
yeah, my favorite was it's a long take where it's just a 360 around the studio.
That was cool.
I can't remember what they were doing.
That's a risky move.
It reminded me of Jean-Luc Godard's Weekend. I high five Dan because that was a guy who likes movies thing to say. I'm sure it'd been done before that. That's just the other example I think of. But no, that
you've referenced Jean-Luc Godard like in your stage banter.
My very first show, I remember I have this song called They Shoot Tigers, and I wrote it after watching Jean-Luc Godard's Made in USA, and I made a reference to it my very first show. I think that's when we became friends.
Yeah. Well, no, we met like in like February.
We had been friends before that for a while, but I feel like in that moment I was like, that I pointed.
Yeah, no.
In my brain.
I was like, woo! And then everybody else was like...
Everyone was like, we love Jean-Luc Godard, especially a movie of his that nobody has seen.
You mentioned a movie at your release show, and my dad was the only one who saw it. Like, Ed Gray.
Oh, Ed Wood.
Ed Wood.
Ed Wood is a great movie. I love Tim Burton.
I know nothing about it.
I love Ed Wood. You've seen Ed Wood, right?
Yeah, I don't remember you mentioning it.
Well, you should have been at the release show then.
I shot a full-length video of it.
Then rewatch it.
Okay.
Vampira is a character in Ed Wood. Yeah. So I talked about Ed Wood because I love that movie. I like movies. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'm just a wacky guy.
I got one bone. I got a big bone to pick with Love and Mercy, though. Because no skeletons.
Okay.
Yeah, it's October. There should be more skeletons in this movie. That's
the thing I want.
We need skeletons in every movie, or I can't stay engaged.
Moving on, another dinner scene. It was like the double date of the 80s era. Brian and Melinda, and then one of Gene's, or one of his quote bodyguards, and his date. Beautiful use of mirrors.
Oh yeah.
That's an obvious, but it was just like one long take, focused on Melinda. And we could see Brian in the mirror.
I don't always love that technique, because mm-hmm. Sometimes it can feel like really, really obvious. But I think it was really tasteful in that scene, because the mirror is sort of like got that little bit of that like a little texture to it, and it's like it's still kind of small, and like the thing is that the way that Elizabeth Banks is lit is like so warm and like glorious, and he's kind of like the smaller part, and you're kind of. I like it when it can be a little bit like tough to decide what you're looking at, which I think in a long take in particular, like that's cool. As far as aesthetics go and camera stuff, I really like that the 60 scenes were shot with
16 millimeter, right?
It's what it looks like. Cause it's got like the little like rack zooms and like, yeah. And like film grain and stuff. I think that look is so cool. I want everybody to look like that.
Yeah, well, they shot it, like, they were just, like, someone standing in the studio, too, which I thought was a really cool effect. Just, like, there are a lot of points where, like, the camera would just be placed in a spot where it's, like, you're just kind of, like, in the corner watching it play out as they're recording stuff. And I thought that was a cool way to kind of immerse you in it. Yeah, something that struck me, too, the accuracy to which they recreated, like, the studio sets. I don't know what the studios actually looked like, but all the instruments were period correct. A lot of the equipment was period correct. Like, so much work had to have fucking gone into that. And I thought it was so impressive, like, just set design, production design-wise, what they were able to pull off with this.
Carol Kay's sunglasses.
Carol Kay. I almost forgot to mention Carol Kay. I fucking let out a little scream when she showed up. I love Carol Kay. The fucking Wrecking Crew is awesome. I had to take an audio engineering course in college when I studied music business for a little bit. And we had like a little day about the Wrecking Crew for some reason. I remember talking about them, and I was like, Carol Kay is the coolest person who's ever existed. She's in this movie and it's great, and her sunglasses are amazing.
There's a Wrecking Crew documentary I watched probably soon after I saw this for the first time. So that's also deep in my memory. Don't remember much. But I do remember that the Wrecking Crew is so prolific that the Beach Pet Sounds was only mentioned briefly. Like, there's so much more to the Wrecking Crew, and even the scene... with the drummer talking to Brian outside, I think it was like after the day, and he's like, "You're touched, kid." Yeah. And like, he was like, we've played with Sinatra, Dean Martin, Phil Spector, which Phil Spector comes back in conversation. He's like, Phil Spector's like out to get me or something when he's starting to lose it.
He's out to get a lot of people.
Okay. I actually have no idea who that is. Phil Spector.
He's a producer.
Also, like, he was convicted, right?
I'm pretty certain.
What happened?
He's a murderer.
Jeez. Yeah.
He produced Abbey Road?
Let It Be. Okay. He worked with the Beatles on Let It Be and is the reason there's so many like crazy orchestral arrangements. He was famous for the Wall of Sound, was kind of his governing philosophy, which is stupid. But he also produced George Harrison's All Things Must Pass, which is like in my top probably two albums ever. But like piece of shit.
And then there's Ronnie Spector.
Ronnie Spector's cool. I fuck with Ronnie Spector.
And that Eddie Money song is like, just like Ronnie said, be my little baby.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, you're welcome. Usually people pay for that.
Can you clip that and then send it to me?
Why don't we sing more on this show?
I think the title, Love and Mercy, is perfect.
Elaborate. I like this. I like this train of thought.
It's, you could even pinpoint where the love is in Brian Wilson's life and the mercy that follows.
Yeah.
He was in love while in Paul Dano era with Marilyn. And I mean, and then with Melinda coming in and therefore getting the mercy of, like, you know, the justice he deserves and the help he deserves. And then ending the end credits, having him playing Love and Mercy, like present day at the time of release. It was perfect.
That was really sweet.
And that's been stuck in my head all day.
Brian and Melinda romance is like amazing. I was perfect. I was so wrapped up in it. I was like, wow, feel stuff. I'm feeling stuff. This is great. Perfect romance.
Yeah, especially like as weird as John Cusack plays in, which you'd have to, like, you'd have to.
Mm-hmm.
I bought it.
Yeah.
And like when I was going into this, watching it again, I was like, there's an age gap and he's kind of weird at the beginning and he has that scary note that says like frightened alone. I was like, it's not really the sexiest way to like hit on a girl, but I bought it fully. But I was like, they are in love and I love them.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fantastic.
This viewing, my most recent viewing, which was yesterday, so it's very fresh. This was the selling point, or this viewing solidified John Cusack's performance. Before, I was wrapped up in, like, he didn't look like him. Not that I, like, super care, but, like, I want to believe the characters I'm watching. With this viewing and with the thought in mind of, like, taking notes for this, I was like, ooh, maybe I'll touch on the savior complex that Melinda will have. Like, oh, she's just out to, like, save this guy, and, oh, cool, he has money, but, like, no. It's, like, pure love. And she takes the spotlight. Elizabeth Banks.
Yeah.
Absolutely slays. And her sweaters.
I looked it up because I was curious, because I didn't know what the actual age gap was. In real life, he is only 4 years older than her. John Cusack is 8 or 9 years. I literally just looked it up and already forgot. 8 or 9 years older than Elizabeth Banks.
Either way.
That's not as bad as I thought, actually. Yeah. She looks really good for her age, and he looks old in this, but that's kind of the point. So, yeah.
What else do you like John Cusack in?
I think he's a great actor.
2012.
Oh no, I forgot about that. That movie scared the hell out of me when it was coming out, because I was like really paranoid about it.
Was that like The Day After Tomorrow?
It was basically the exact same movie, but about the 2012 like prophecy of the world ending, and John Cusack Mayans is the lead. Yeah.
Was he good though, you're saying, or you're just talking? You're just
I don't remember anything. I don't remember anything about that movie.
I remember that Woody Harrelson plays like a crazy dude, and he's like on top of a mountain and he's like screaming, and then same director as Day After Tomorrow. Roland Emmerich also did Independence Day. Pretty sure
That checks out. I think you're right.
Actually, I kind of felt like I first recognized John Cusack as a good actor when I saw the movie Chi-Raq. I don't know if you've seen that one.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
Is that about Chicago?
It is. Spike Lee movie. My screenwriting professor in college wrote that movie. So we went to go see it, and I was like, John Cusack, I don't know about that. And he was really good in it. And I was like, wow, okay, super underrated. All of his, you know, 80s stuff is good. I don't care about High Fidelity, though.
I was going to ask about that.
I don't care for it.
I've never seen High Fidelity, but the two movies I like him in that my dad really loves both these movies are The Sure Thing and Gross Point Blank. Mm-hmm. Are two movies I watched younger than I probably should have and really enjoyed that he's in. Those rent a lot of space in my head in terms of thinking about John Cusack.
I don't know what else I've seen him in.
Say Anything?
No.
Yeah,
just list off his movies. I'll say okay. Yes or
everybody
no. This
tune
is interesting.
In. IMDb coming right up.
Is he in Being John Malkovich?
Oh, duh, yeah.
Okay, I have seen that.
I like him in that a lot, actually.
I hated the movie.
I have not watched that in a long time, but I remember that was one of the first like thinky movies I ever saw, and I was like, movies can have ideas that are heady and weird. I don't know why that was the revelation to me, but that was one of the first ones where I was like, oh, this is really weird and I'm into it.
I agree. All movies should be like Spy Kids too.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Island of Lost Dreams, dude?
Yes.
Let's go. You know what the best part of Island of Lost Dreams is the skeletons, okay?
Yeah.
That's true. When they're climbing up.
Yeah. Well, there's the part I like. I actually looked this up recently because I was like, wait, that happened in this movie, right? Is the scene where they like steal something out of like a tomb and then all the skeletons come running after them and then the evil spy kids, the like bad spy kids that they're feuding with come out and they get into a fight and then not Junie, what's the girl's name?
Alexa is the actress name.
Yeah. So she says like she gets the guy with some like hilarious line and all the skeletons are now just watching and they go woo. they're like cheering and then like they both have like monsters that they ride and the monsters fight and the skeletons are like cheering and watching. And I'm like, when I was a kid, I was like, that's the funniest thing of all time. Because I was like, these skeletons who were previously really pissed off are now like a comedic.
Carmen?
Carmen, yes.
That weirdly doesn't even sound right.
Junie and Carmen.
Right. I know I'm reading very well.
Hey, someone come on the show and do Spy Kids.
I'll come
challenge.
Back.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, John Cusack movies.
Star-studded. The first one, at least.
John Cusack movies include Stand By Me. I don't know if I've seen
Stand By Me. Paul Giamatti, also the villain in Big Fat Liar.
True.
That was the first time I saw him.
That might be the only other movie I've seen that he's in.
Oh, you got to see Sideways.
You got to see Sideways. I haven't seen it, but you should see it.
John Cusack. Yeah, Being John Malkovich. Adaptation.
Yeah.
Thin Red Line. 2012. 16 Candles. 1408, Stephen King adaptations. Terrible.
Is that the hotel one?
Yes.
Hotel room?
That's
I think
The Shining.
Oh, yeah. Go back to the previous episode.
Episode? Oh, of this?
Of this show, yeah. Hot Tub Time Machine. How can we forget?
Oh.
Anyway, that's the end of this bit. Thanks for joining me on What is John Cusack in?
I keep not knowing where to talk into this microphone.
So you gotta look at this is the...
Okay, I'm glad that I'm figuring this out as we wrap up the episode, where to talk into this mic. Overall, just thought, my take was like, I hadn't seen this movie since it came out. And I remember liking it, but I didn't remember paying much attention to it. So I was like, oh, I'm excited to watch it again. But like, I didn't really know what to expect. I didn't remember much. It's so good.
Mm-hmm.
It's a really good movie.
Mm-hmm.
I was so entertained and engaged and emotional. Overall, I thought the John Cusack stuff was a lot more interesting than the Paul Dano stuff, but I was like engaged with both of them just for different reasons. And yeah, it made lots of creative choices that I just didn't expect it to get as weird as it did at certain times. Like there's a whole kind of psychedelic-y sequence toward the end where it like goes into his ear canal and there's like the bed and it's different time, like stuff like that, where I was just like, I didn't expect it to take any risks being a biopic, but it's really a creative movie and I enjoyed it a lot.
I'm glad. I think this should be more widely recognized. I just never hear anyone talk about it. Even when like Bohemian Rhapsody came out, I was like, oh, I want to watch more biopics. And then
yeah, it's a great movie, and I kind of forgot how much I loved it. All the performances are really good, and it then like I really enjoy seeing something that sends me off on a little knowledge adventure like this one did. And I think, you know, we talked a lot about the inconsistencies with real life or whatever, but I think to the point of it being such an emotionally rich film, it's like so cool. Like the love story is really nice. I love seeing the creative journey that he had, and the, like just, you know, the way that this man's life unfolded and all the kind of crazy weird turns and twists and influences that come along, and I think it's a really good story. Like I said, I want to see like a Beach Boy. I want to see give me like a 6-hour fucking Beach Boys documentary, and I will eat that up. Like
I'm sure it's out there.
Maybe
when I got into Star Trek, there was like 26 episodes of 1-hour history of Star Trek.
Yeah, great film. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you for watching it.
Thank you for listening. If you did, do you want to say anything that's you got going on?
If you're listening to this on release day, come to my show at Subterranean tomorrow. My band Pretty Please is playing with rock legends Roswell Kid. They are our biggest influence, and it might sound like we're copying them before them. So you could say, oh, they're doing a Bring It On. They're bringing on in their set. They just copy the same performance before them. Check out our new album, Classic Rock. There is physical media available if you want to do that.
Thanks. Josh, thank you for coming on. This is a wonderful film, and you are a wonderful human being.
Thank you. I feel the exact same. I would love to talk more off air.
Maybe.
Yeah, I'm tired.
I'm really tired. I used to talk about Love and Mercy after we stopped recording.
I'll never think about it. Good night, everybody.
Good night, San Diego.
Bye.